James Vanderbeek plus O-Town Performs next live.
Ladies and gentlemen, the star of Politically Incorrect, Bill Maher.
Thank you very much. All right, let us meet our panel. Thank you. Please. Calm down. There are bigger stars than me here. She's a Nixon biographer, political commentator for Fox News, and an editor-at-large for Talk Magazine, Dr. Monica Crowley. Doctor, where are you? One of my favorite doctors. How you doing? A former big-time studio honcho, Prexy, and now he's the vice president and editor-in-chief of Variety, Peter Bart. Mr. Bart. Good to see you back here, sir. He is the close personal friend of Jimmy Glick, who David Manning, the critic who doesn't exist, get it, calls the best critic of all time, the big show Primetime Glick, which I am a guest on.
Yes, you are.
Exactly. Premieres June 20th on Comedy Central, and it is about the funniest thing ever. Martin Short is behind it, of course.
Hey, Bill.
He's a big-time movie star and Tony-nominated actor and General James Doolittle from the big hit Pearl Harbor in theaters everywhere, Alec Baldwin, ladies and gentlemen. That's great. How are you, Pam? Good to see you. All right. So this is perfect. We have a political animal. I know you love politics, and we have a gossip.
Yes.
You're now...
Absolutely true.
You're now a gossip columnist.
Yes, I am.
And it's great, because this week in the press, all the dirt now is coming out about Clinton and Gore. Apparently, they hated each other all along. No love lost. I won't get into all that. What I wanted to ask is, since you're a Nixon biographer, the comparison between Gore and Nixon. Because here's two vice presidents who followed two terms of a successful presidency and didn't make it. And... you know, I guess the people who are not that big of fans of George Bush are thinking that maybe if George Bush doesn't do well in 2004, 2008, Al Gore can say, I told you so. But that wouldn't be good for Al Gore since he's known as an I told you so. You see the trap that I think is...
Yeah. I'm sorry, I was listening. What were you saying? Something about Nixon.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm saying that...
Start again.
That if Bush messes up, I mean more than he is, then Al Gore will have to run as, see, I told you so, but people don't like that about him.
That's right. True.
Yeah, but see, I don't think there are very many parallels or significant parallels between Nixon and Gore, because Nixon, regardless of what you ever thought of him, he was always considered a heavyweight. So when he came back in 1968 and ran, he had enormous support. Al Gore has no support even within his own party. The Democrats don't like him, and
oh,
they
on.
Don't want him to run in 4 years.
No, Bush is the one who's not the heavyweight. Come on.
No, you have to give George Bush a chance, Bill. He's been president for 15 minutes. Give him a chance.
And it's been a long 15
minutes. That's what he said.
Oh. No, mercy. Mercy. Oh. Mercy, mama. No, I think the worst thing you can say about Al Gore is that he lost to George W. Bush. I mean, that's the point. Truthfully.
Yeah,
and
no,
he had the force of the Baldwin brothers behind him, and that didn't help either. You know.
No, but also the argument could be made that of course, that Gore did not lose to Bush. That Bush is the president
He lost the Electoral College, which is the only jackpot that really matters. And I don't hear anybody calling Al Gore Mr. President right now.
No. I mean, that's an obvious and very small point. But the idea being that to compare Gore and Nixon, I don't think is really...
Before we revisit Nixon so fondly here, let's remember that I think 8 days before he died, he said that Whitewater was vastly more important and weighty and dangerous than Watergate. I mean, give me a break.
Yeah.
Whitewater was nothing. Watergate buried a president, ruined a generation of politicians. So I think you remember...
Ruined the country.
And it ruined the press.
Ruined the country.
Anyway, getting back to Al Gore, though, I don't think he stands a chance. I think he's finished. I think he's done.
But that is exactly what they said about Nixon. Excuse me.
Nixon had a lot of support within the Republican Party when he came back in 1968.
He certainly did not.
Al Gore is considered done.
Nixon himself wrote his own obituary. He said, "You won't have Nixon to kick around anymore."
But he didn't really mean it.
He didn't really mean it.
I think he meant it. No, I mean, listen, it's true. If Al Gore now ran for governor of California and lost, you'd really assume that I mean, that was Nixon, what Nixon did. I think everyone thought he was pretty finished.
He was pretty. He was dead. It was a joke.
And you had to run Goldwater in 64, who was so much more of an extremist then than Nixon, to make Nixon look like a moderate in 68.
But Nixon actually was a moderate, Alec. I mean, if you take a look at his domestic initiatives, the Environmental Protection Agency,
there were some very moderate things he did, but he was rather immoderate in the way that he kind of criminalized the White House.
He was a psychotic moderate. That was the only problem.
He was a sociopathic moderate.
No, I resent those characterizations, since I'm the only one on this panel who actually knew Richard Nixon. I would dispute that characterization. But
you know him. I've had him.
Yeah.
No, but seriously, there's a lot of great things that Nixon did. You're right. The National Endowment for the Arts and public broadcasting and things like that with Len Garman with China, Détente with China. But to compare Nixon and Gore, I think, merely for the idea of them being a vice president coming out of a two-term White House who would lose the election, that's really where the distinction
ends. But here's also a crucial distinction. I mean, when Nixon was vice president, he served under an enormously respected man, Dwight Eisenhower, okay? Al Gore served under Bill Clinton. And when we talk about Clinton fatigue, it's always Al Gore. I mean, that's one of the main reasons why he lost in November, was because of Clinton-Gore fatigue. And I don't see how he overcomes that even in 3 years.
The reason he lost is that he refused to embrace Clinton's success.
This is precisely the reason of Clinton fatigue, and he also lost
because, let's not forget, because we let this guy off the hook, that wheezing, broken down windbag Nader was running around the country, stealing all those votes.
And
that's who I voted for.
That's why I said that as delicately as I did.
But also that unfortunate shallow end of it is that Al Gore sounds like that, how Cyworld left.
Yeah.
And sometimes
he does.
They just, you know, and it wasn't until George W. Bush went on Oprah and seemed like he wasn't, you know, completely brain dead, that people were willing to embrace him and said, well, he seems like a pleasant enough
fellow. What do you think Nixon would have thought of George Bush? Because Nixon was famous for being a self-made man who only admired self-made men. What do you think he would have thought of?
He would have said he's a patrician nothing. I don't think he liked sort of outsiders like Henry Kissinger. I mean, he respectabilized Henry Kissinger today.
Guys who had the goods.
Would be starring with you in the producers, do you know?
Well, I mean, I think
Kissinger's gay.
Nixon.
Where have you been?
Not.
No. I've had him.
No, but
you met everybody.
Nixon was a man of substance. He was an intellect. He read voraciously. He had enormous intellectual curiosity. And I agree with Peter to the extent that his judgment of former President Bush was along those lines, where he did think he was a patrician who believed that he was entitled to the presidency, didn't have a real hunger for it. And his view on former President Bush was that he was a good man, but not a strong man politically. And I think the same judgment would have held for President Bush.
What do you think of Bush?
I think that Bush is doing a very good job so far. Well, and I think he is.
What are you basing that on?
He is a lot more intelligent than his critics give him credit for. Mm-hmm. And I think he has shown leadership in a number of areas where he's attracted a lot of criticism, particularly on the tax cut, which was signed into law today. That was a huge victory for George Bush. And you can't tell me Mr. Famous Movie Star, Mr. Famous Editor, Mr. Famous TV Host, and Mr.
Dancer.
Famous Movie Star, that you're not looking forward to your tax rebate from
that
this
600
tax
bucks
cut
is burning a hole in my pocket.
All right, I got to take a break. We'll be right back. On a day when his daughters landed on the cover of People magazine with the headline, "Oops, they did it again," President Bush addressed the National Summit of Fatherhood. That's true. And in light of his recent problems, unveiled his new slogan, "Leave no child under the table."
Politically Incorrect with Bill Maher, brought to you by Chevrolet.
Beautiful car.
200 horsepower, V6 engine.
Got your name written all over it. You like it?
I love it.
I feel a test drive coming on. You ready? I'm ready.
I'm done. I want this car. I will take this car.
You've got to take it for a test drive.
No, I'm going to take the car. I want it.
Let's put this thing on the road.
Let's go for a test drive.
Mm-hmm.
Test drive over. I want the car.
Chevy Impala.
I love this car.
We'll be there.
You know, if it weren't for my wife's arthritis, she wouldn't be here today. She's always depended on Extra Strength Bayer for arthritis pain. Nothing worked better.
When Mom had a heart attack, she knew to take Original Strength Bayer, like the doctor said.
Bayer not only took care of my mom's arthritis pain, aspirin actually helped save her life.
Knowing all that Bayer can do, why would anyone choose another pain reliever?
Bayer. Take it for pain. Take it for life.
It's just beautiful up here.
Oh, it's so peaceful and quiet.
Honey, there's not a soul around. You want a mint?
Trident makes mint.
Mm-hmm.
Introducing a sugarless mint from Trident that strengthens teeth and helps reduce the risk of tooth decay.
I have a rug that looks just like you.
The baby business is booming, but would you offer to sell your own child for a few hundred dollars? It's happening here. Children born to be sold, and those may be the lucky ones. What will it take to save them? You'll never forget this 2020 Friday.
No matter where I travel, home is the best destination of all. By trusting my muffler, brakes, and shocks to the pros at Meineke, I know I'll always get there.
At Meineke, you won't pay a lot, but you'll get a lot.
If your ride is getting a little rough, you know where to go. Come on, George. Get to Meineke, buy one shock or strut, and get a big 50% off the second one.
At Meineke, you won't pay a lot, but you'll get a lot.
Circuit City makes it easy to find the perfect gift for Father's Day. And Dad's gift could be free when you play the perfect gift giveaway. Get your free game card today at any participating Circuit City store for your chance to scratch it, match it, and win it. Hundreds of prizes are up for grabs, from big screen TVs and laptop computers to digital camcorders, Palm Pilots, MP3 players, and more. All when you scratch it, match it, and win it right now at Circuit City.
Responding to the president's claim that global warming needs more study, the National Academy of Sciences produced one today, finding that indeed global warming is real, is getting worse, and is mostly caused by burning fossil fuels. President Bush said he's really looking forward to reading the study, but for now, he asked the FBI to hold on to it for safekeeping. Okay, talking about what we were talking about, I was watching Gladiator. Have you seen Gladiator?
Yes.
You seen Gladiator?
Yes.
Oh. Okay. I saw it in the theater. I watched it again. It was on cable this month. And I swear to God, from now on, I cannot help but think of Bush and McCain as that's the Gladiator story. Maximus, right? The war hero. McCain, the guy deserving. And then the emperor's son... Who's
Joaquin
not,
Phoenix yeah, as Bush. Okay. Joaquin Bush, Jr.
Every time I see Bush now, I think of Joaquin Phoenix.
Joaquin will be so devastated.
Finally, your comments. but, you know, Bush had this, McCain, rather, had this thing in Arizona with Daschle, and people have been saying maybe he's going to switch parties. I don't think that's going to happen. I think people forget that John McCain is not a liberal. His rating from the Liberal American for Democratic Action, 9 out of 100. The American Conservative Union gives him an 86.
Right.
Why are the liberals so in love with a guy who gets a 9 out of 100?
Yeah, it's very funny.
Well, it's another vote for the Senate. Isn't it just about politics?
Well, and McCain isn't going anywhere.
No.
The Republican Party is still his home. As you mentioned, he's a very conservative voting record. He's pro-life. He's been a longtime advocate of tax cuts and fiscal responsibility and defense and so forth. He is not going to leave the Republican Party, certainly not to become a Democrat. But what he is doing right now is using his position in the catbird seat to try to extract concessions from both parties on campaign finance, which is his big issue. And he knows that the Republicans don't want to lose him and the Democrats want him, and he's exploiting that position. I think he's doing it brilliantly.
And you should point out that since I'm the only Republican here, you should point out.
I can do character work. Doesn't that count for anything in this America?
You should point out that the other groups that are against campaign tax reform, right, are labor and the black bloc. So you've got two so-called liberal blocs that are totally antagonistic to campaign finance, which is being championed by a Republican.
It's a corrupt system, which is why I voted for Ralph Nader.
And why you're a libertarian.
What's that?
You're a libertarian, right?
I'm a libertarian, yes.
Right. Okay.
But also, I mean, the Democrats are also in the pockets of people who give them money. And it's, I mean, my line was always that the Democrats...
I thought John Corzine's campaign was one of the most egregious examples of that. I mean, he's a Democrat and he won the seat, but the guy ponies up $35 million and he bought a Senate seat.
Yeah.
I mean, that's disgusting. Right.
Yeah. And that's my home state, New Jersey. So.
That's right.
Yeah. It used to be my home state, too.
And Bloomberg will do it in
the
city of Manhattan.
Buy the mayoralty in New York.
He'll buy Manhattan.
And he said, I'm going to buy it.
Although money is the only issue.
Did Nader really run a pristine campaign? Was there no, I mean,
Are you kidding? Did you see that suit?
All right, point taken.
This guy can't afford dry cleaning. Yeah. Are you kidding?
That's true.
Yeah. And that's why, you know, he got like nothing. And by the way, he didn't lose the election for Al Gore. Al Gore lost the election all by himself, and as we pointed out, didn't really even lose the election. But I mean, I don't think you can find any election where there isn't some third-party candidate who siphons off 1 or 2% of the votes. And if you are the sitting vice president with that economic record behind you, and you can't overcome
that. And that's precisely why the Democrats don't want Al Gore to run, because with incredible prosperity and incredible peace,
but excuse me, like many, many people who do what you do for a living, and especially for Fox, you make these very broad pronouncements. The Democrats don't want Gore. How do you know that?
Yeah.
How do you know what the Democrats want and what they don't want? How do you know that? How do you know Gore is unpopular with Democrats?
In my capacity as a political commentator for Fox, I have to debate Democrats all the time, and I talk to them both on and off the record, and I know that they cannot stand Al Gore because he screwed up this election. He had the wind at his back, and he still couldn't even win his home state of Tennessee, which would have put him over the top.
To the original point, Nixon was in a similar hole, even deeper, in 60 and more in 62, and the Republicans didn't want him either.
But Nixon didn't have a sideways left, and that is a problem.
You know, I've said this, you are so right. Al Gore sounds...
It's so cruel of you.
No, yeah. It's not cruel at all. It's more of a love letter when you think of it. All I'm saying is that we're shallowy voters.
He sounds like a southern gay man who's trying to hide the fact that he's gay, because you don't want, when you're in this... Nobody comes out in Birmingham, Alabama. You just don't. So you tend to over-exaggerate your speech pattern to be perfect, so you don't sound like this. I'm not saying Al Gore is gay. I'm just saying... That the American...
That really is the great thing about this show. You come on this show to get the right mix of people. Nixon's a saint. Gore is gay. By the time we're done with the wash cycle here, it's amazing what you can learn.
I'm not saying he is gay. I'm just saying that the people are shallow. The American public is shallow. And why did they choose Bush? I used to call it the Cheers election. They would rather have Norm, you know, the beer-drinking buddy, then Cliff, the smart guy.
But I'll tell you something interesting about that. I would have bet early on in that race, I would have bet, if McCain was running against Gore, I mean, as a Democrat that wanted Gore to win, I was terrified of McCain. I thought McCain is going to kick his ass. You know what I mean? McCain is tough. He's for real. He's genuine. He's self-made. The thing about, you say, what do liberals and Democrats want to embrace about McCain? Hey, if I'm going to lose the White House to the Republicans, I'd rather lose to the White House to a Republican who I think really stands for something than this guy who's been shilled and fronted and had the whole way eased for him his whole life, you know, getting money from the state of Texas to build a stadium so he can shove $18 million in his pocket.
Yeah, like, I think it goes back to Nixon, too, you know, because after Nixon left and everyone was concerned that the country was just going to collapse, and Gerald Ford became vice president, and you just said, oh, my God, in heaven. And yet we were fine, and I think after that everyone said, maybe the position is more about being comfortable with someone and not being so convinced that they will make or break.
Yeah, and I also think that your characterization of Bush, though, is unfair, because I think anybody who's running for president is indebted to special interests. They're all taking the money, Democrats, too. So Al Gore also had his way.
But not to the degree.
He was also to the manor born. His father was U.S. Senator.
But Gore was not as undeserving of what happened to him.
We're talking about Harvard and Yale.
Bush can remember what happened from 40 below.
But on an intellectual level, the difference between Gore and Bush is like the difference between a cannon and a pea shooter. So, I mean, it's like...
No, I think that's unfair, Alec. Yeah. And I also think that Bush won because he happened to stand for issues that the American public believed in and wanted to see affected into policy. Tax cuts, very popular. $1.35 trillion tax cuts, very popular.
But it's
pro-defense, reduce the size of government.
Let's talk about this tax cut thing for a minute.
That is so not true.
The idea... Gore had the ideas more that people believed in. They just didn't like him.
No, well, I think it sounds unlikable.
They didn't like him.
But
I have to take a break or my network will not like me.
Join us tomorrow when our guest will be recording artist Coolio. From Gideon's Crossing, Eric Dane. Writer-director Stella Stevens. And Republican strategist Tara Setmaier.
Will she feel the same way if you lose your hair?
Sure. She'll just feel it about somebody else.
Don't worry, I love you. Anyway, you don't have to lose it.
Are you talking about Rogaine?
Rogaine. Maybe. Why not?
Rogaine. Yeah, why not? It's simple, it's safe, and it's clinically proven to help stop hair loss and regrow hair. Does she want you to use Rogaine? Better ask.
In 1998, thousands of families were forced to flee the tragedy in Kosovo. We at the Philip Morris Companies felt we needed to do something to help them. So we sent 5 tons of food.
Hi, I'm Molly from Philip Morris.
And I went along to see that it got there.
Hi, are you American?
Yeah.
Want to ride?
I know there's plenty of people who need help in our own country, and we do that. But we couldn't turn our backs on a crisis like this.
For more than 40 years, the Philip Morris Companies have been one of the largest corporate contributors to disaster relief efforts in the United States and around the world.
You know, it's funny, I thought I was coming all this way to do something that would touch their lives, but it turns out they were the ones who touched mine.
Working to make a difference, the people of Philip Morris.
Heads up, Disneyland. We have a new neighbor.
Introducing Disney's California Adventure. Visit Disney.com to book your vacation to Disney's California Adventure.
Recycle wrap, take one.
We all make trash, and that's the problem. But how we deal with it, that's our job.
Get with the program, get in the know. Recycling is the way to go.
Green takes the paper stuff, blue takes bottles and cans, gray takes the rest. You got it, man.
Reusing things can make the dip. Just don't litter, got my drip.
So you and me, let's make it real. Reduce, reuse, recycle. That's the deal.
Respect.
You the can.
Nah, you the can.
Reduce, reuse, recycle. Thanks for doing your part, New York.
Who are you?
I'm not what you think I am.
Critics are saying Swordfish is the French Connection meets the Matrix. If it were any hotter, you'd burst into flame. The high-impact, high-energy, high-tech thriller that takes no prisoners.
Let me go!
Prepare to be blown to the back of the theater.
Hold on!
The password is electrifying.
Oh, yeah.
Swordfish, rated R, starts tomorrow at a theater near you.
Oi, baby. Why, I want to go to this big store just for men like you.
Don't miss today's man's huge buy one, get one free clothing sale on special selections of thousands of suits from $199 to $449, buy one, get one free. Sport coats from $139 to $249, buy one, get one free. Trousers from $59.90 to $99.90, buy one, get one free. Only at today's man.
It's how you say huge, just like you.
Today's man, the menswear superstore.
Okay, we're talking politics. Now, if there's one thing Republicans and Democrats agree on, is that poverty and violence are caused by dirty talk on television. Right?
I've always said that.
And,
how could it be otherwise?
I noticed today
George Bush's head of the FCC is Colin Powell's son. Did you know this?
Yeah. Michael Powell.
Michael Powell. Colin Powell's son is now head of the FCC. I wonder how he got that job. Anyway, they're going after Eminem on the radio for the real Slim Shady. And I read this, I thought, you know what? At 8 o'clock on any show, especially like the hip urban shows like Friends, there is more poo-poo caca jokes at 8 o'clock at
Absolutely.
Night.
Absolutely.
Which is fine for me.
They did a very special David Schwimmer Conquers Non-Specific Urethritis just on last week. I mean, I taped it. I haven't seen it, but I have a feeling.
I mean, I'm an adult with no kids. I don't care. But, I mean, seriously, if I had kids, I would wonder about what goes on at 8 o'clock at night on network television.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And with good reason. I mean, you know, the networks are always sort of interested in pushing the envelope and seeing how far they can go. And there's a lot of pressure now coming from a lot of these popular cable shows like The Sopranos and Oz and Sex and the City. So now I think primetime networks taking a look at their programming and saying, well, how can we go further even than we are? You talked about Friends. Their season finale featured a transvestite, right? A man played by Kathleen Turner, brilliantly, I think.
Yeah.
And also an out-of-wedlock pregnancy. Okay? But Jennifer Aniston's character.
That's what most people have, a transvestite dad.
No. But that's my point, Bill. That's my point. I mean, I think that the writers and the producers of these shows have a broader social responsibility.
But on Sex and the City this week, according to a Variety tabulation, the word vagina was mentioned 35 times. This wasn't the vagina monologues. This was a vagina diatribe. And I got to tell you, the show is brilliant, though. It sets a different bar for television, and more power to it.
Mm-hmm. But that's
right. So like a classic editor of a famous magazine, I can't quite tell, were you in favor of it or not in favor?
I was.
You just did that so brilliantly. You commented on it without really. Yeah, it was like.
I was utterly in favor of it.
You're utterly in favor.
Have you seen the vagina monologues?
Yes, I have.
Because I hate ventriloquism, so I just refuse to go. We have to take a break. We'll be right back.
Nice table, Ving.
Nice phone. Want to play for it?
And if I win?
How about this?
Now, the best thing about this phone, Ving, it's prepaid. Pay as you go.
With TrackPhone, there's no contract or monthly bill, and after $100 in total rebates, the Motorola StarTAC is just $29.99.
I'm selling this table.
To demonstrate how quickly new Capstar kills fleas, we gave Herman a Capstar tablet 30 minutes ago. Observe.
The fastest relief with no pesticide residue. It's Capstar.
The most powerful Duracell Ultra ever. With M3 technology, it's the most powerful alkaline battery in the world.
Welcome to the beast. Welcome to the beast.
Here, see, someone get killed.
You gotta talk to this guy, Jackson. He's out of control.
You have the right to remain silent. In other words, you're on camera.
You mean right now?
At all times.
Welcome to the beast.
The Beast. Series premiere Wednesday on ABC. Viewer discretion is advised.
Prostate cancer is the leading killer of men over 50. With early detection, survival can be 100%. GHI supports ABC7's Prostate Cancer Awareness Campaign because we know good health begins with education. Knowing is living.
When's your birthday? I never had a birthday.
Feel it. Touch it.
That's creepy.
Whoa. That's so real.
Inside, he's like all the rest. But outside, he just looks so real.
If you change your mind, I'm the first in line. Honey, I'm still free. Take a chance on me. If you need me, let me know. Gonna be around.
Down.
on colorectal cancer. This year, nearly 57,000 people will die of it. But regular screening tests could save thousands of lives. So talk to your doctor and screen for life.
Yeah, in today's world, you could almost do that. Okay, tomorrow, Coolio, Eric Dane, Stella Stevens. Wow, one of the first, never mind. And Tara Settmeyer.